Hello everybody and welcome to another Naval Action Ship Review. So today we're taking a look at a very fast ship, the Endymion. So let's begin with history. In April 1797, Captain Thomas Williams commissioned the Endymion for Channel and Irish Station. In October, Endymion joined the North Sea Fleet with orders to pursue the scattered Dutch ships in the aftermath after the Battle of Camperdown. Within hours, Endymion encountered the ship of the line Brutus, close inshore, but the protected anchorage prevented Williams from successfully attacking the Dutch ship and she was able to escape. For the next 3 years, Williams was employed off Ireland and on convoy to the island of St. Helena. In early 1798, Endymion captured four privateers while cruising off the Irish coast, and in late 1799 to May 1800, Endymion captured a number of French and Spanish vessels. Endymion was sailing in company with Champion and convoy for the Mediterranean when they come upon a heavily laden Portuguese ship from Brazil, totally demasted and abandoned. The British, after considerable exertion, were able to put her into a navigable state. Champion then towed her into Gibraltar. In 1801, Williams assumed command of a 74-gun frigate, and as such, Captain Philip Charles replaced Williams. When war broke out again in 1803, she was part of the blockading squadron of Brest until 1805. During these first years of service, Endymion took a number of French and Spanish prizes, mainly merchantmen and privateers, but also some warships of up to 20 guns. In autumn 1805, Endymion joined the squadron of Rear Admiral Lewis of Cadiz, part of Vice Admiral Nelson's fleet, blockading the Allied Franco-Spanish force under Admiral Villeneuve. On the 2nd of October, however, Nelson orders Lewis's five ships of the line with Endymion to Gibraltar for water and provisions. In consequence, Endymion would miss the Battle of Trafalgar on the 21st of October. In 1807, she took part in the Dardanelles operation, where she was detached to Constantinople with the British ambassador for negotiations with the Ottoman Empire. The mission, however, was a failure, and when the squadron sailed back through the Dardanelles, Turkish shore batteries attacked the British, with Endymion suffering 3 killed and 9 wounded. From 1808 on, Endymion served again in home waters, where she took a number of French privateers. In August 1810, Endymion, in company with HMS Princess Charlotte, sailed to the then little known remote island of Rockall. John Porter's memoir was long accepted for dating the first landing on Rockall as being on this voyage, on 8th of July 1810. However, examining Endymion's own logs at the Public Record Office, James Fisher of the 1955 Rockall landing discovered that the first landing date was actually Sunday 8th September 1811. One of her lieutenants during the 1810 voyage was one of Basil Hall, who was still with the ship when the 1810 landing was made. In July 1811, Endymion was again within sight of Rockall and made soundings of the Rockall bank. By 8 September, she had returned. Lieutenant Basil Hall was part of this first landing party upon it, probably under the command of Lieutenant Richard Israel Allion, Endymion's first lieutenant. The landing appears to have begun mostly casually. To quote Hall's own book, "As we had nothing better on our hands, it was resolved to make an exploration expedition to visit the little islet. Two boats were accordingly manned for the purpose. The artists prepared their sketchbooks and the geologists their hammers, for a grand scientific field day." Whilst indicating the impromptu nature of the landing, this also signifies that science was a deliberate aim from the first. The sea on this fine autumnal morning was unusually smooth, but a swell of many feet made landing difficult and required a great deal of confidence when leaping ashore. Observations and measurements were made until a fog was observed. Concern over the Endymion's continuing visibility caused them to begin their return. The increasing swell made embarking difficulty, and it took half an hour to gain the boat. By this time, Endymion was lost in the fog. One of the party was landed back on the rock in an attempt to scale it in search of a fog-free lookout. His first view was of an approaching fog bank, which in this area could last for some days. The ship was sighted, however, and after another delay to retrieve their shivering scout, they rowed off in chase. Unfortunately, the ship didn't see them before the fog returned, and they were forced to return yet again to Rockall. At this point, planning began for a long stay on the island. Despite the lack of provisions or fresh water, it was resolved to abandon the heavier of the two boats, and to try the other ashore to improvise an overnight shelter. Fortunately, they were saved by the fog, suddenly rising, revealing the ship once more. On finally returning to the ship, some 5 or 6 hours after the fog, it was almost dark. Although Hall wasn't alone in the landing party, and unlikely to have been either its commander or the Shivering Scout, he is known for having been the only person to publish a written account of it. The 1955 landing thus named the big ledge near the top where they erected the flagpole, Hall's Ledge, after only knowing the new for certain. In 1812, Anderman underwent a large repair at Plymouth, finally docking out in July 1813. Two further 42-pound carronades were added to her armament, and her complement was increased to 340 men. She was then detached to North America, where she captured some American privateers, where her crew undertook several boat attacks to raid American shipping. Her boats attempted to capture the notorious American privateer Prince de Neufchâtel, which at some point will be getting a naval action, but they were unsuccessful. In all, Anderman lost over 100 men killed, wounded, or prisoners. In the attempt, at the time, Prince de Neufchâtel was under the command of John Ordronneau, who was also one of her three owners. She was armed with 17 to 18 guns, almost all 18-pound carronades, and had a crew of 140 men, so that's like a kill-death ratio of almost one for those men. In August, Anderman took part in the expeditions up to Penobscot River in Maine. The first ships to go were Sylph, Dragon, Anderman, Bashant, Peruvian, as well as some transport. Bulwark, Tenedos, Rifleman, and Pictou joined on the 31st. On the evening of 31st August, Sylph, Peruvian, and the transport Harmony, accompanied by a boat from the Dragoons, embarked Marines, foot soldiers, and the detachments from the Royal Artillery to move up to the Penobscot under the command of Captain Robert Barry of Dragon. The object was the American frigate Adams of 26 18-pound guns, which had taken refugees from 27 miles upstream at Hampton, Maine. Here Adams had landed her guns and fortified a position on the bank with 15 18-pound guns commanding the river. Moving up the river took 2 days, but eventually, after the Battle of Hampton, the British were able to capture the American defenders at Bangor, though not until after the Americans had burnt the Adams. The British also captured 11 other ships and destroyed 6. The British lost only one man killed, a sailor from Dragon, and had several wounded. On 14th of January 1815, the most significant event in Anderman's history happened. The USS President, under the command of Commodore Stephen de Courtauld, left New York for a mission in the Indian Ocean. She then fell in with the British blockading squadron, consisting of the Razet, Majestic, and the frigates Anderman, Paname, and Tenedos. Immediately, the British squadron gave chase with Majestic leading. At noon, the Anderman, being an excellent sailor, overhauled her squadron and left them behind. At 2 p.m., she gained on the President and took position on the American ship's quarter, shooting into the President as she tried to escape. Anderman was able to rake the President 3 times and did considerable damage to her. By contrast, President primarily directed her fire at Anderman's rigging in order to slow her down. Finally, at 7:58 p.m., President ceased fire and hoisted a light in her rigging, indicating that she had struck her colors. Anderman's foresails had been damaged in the engagement, and she hove to for repairs to the rigging, being unable to take possession of her prize due to the lack of boats that would swim. Whilst Anderman was engaged in repairs, Commodore Stephen Decatur took advantage of that fact, and despite having struck, made off to escape at 8:30 p.m. Anderman, still engaged in repairs, could not immediately pursue and resumed the chase at 8:52 p.m. At 9:05 p.m, Pomon and Tenedos came up with the heavily damaged President. Unaware that the enemy had already struck, Pomon fired 2 broadsides into the President, following which Decatur again struck his ship and hailed the British to say that he had surrendered. Shortly afterwards, Captain Lumley of Pomon took possession of President. According to British accounts, President had lost 35 men killed and 70 wounded, including Decatur. American sources give the losses as 24 killed and 55 wounded. Anderman had 11 killed and 14 wounded. There has been a long-running debate over whether Anderman had beaten President or President had beaten Anderman. Clearly, President could not fight the normal duel, such as which USS Constitution fought with Java. Had Decatur tried to fight Anderman broadside to broadside, he would have had little chance of escaping the other British ships. His only hope was to get rid of the Anderman by dismasting her, and this he failed in. Striking to the Anderman before this could be accomplished, a fact confirmed by Mr. Bowie, not David Bowie, ship's chaplain of the President, who confirmed the raising of the light indicating surrender to Anderman. On the other hand, Anderman, as the smaller and weaker ship, managed to slow down and damage the American frigate, pouring in 3 raking broadsides that caused heavy casualties and forcing her to strike. However, it is also asserted that far from surrendering to Endymion, President had actually disabled Endymion and removed her from the pursuit. Instead, President was only forced to surrender when Pawn and Trundle come up. This is uncertainty is of early date and is reflected in Commodore Decatur's own recorded comments. Decatur made a deposition before the British Admiralty Court at St. George's, Bermuda in January 1815. In this, it is recorded that when Pomona's boat boarded President, Decatur insisted that his sword be sent to the captain of the Black Ship, referring to the Endymion, as he had struck to her alone. However, in his later dispatch, primarily for American consumption, he contradicted this statement. There has also been much discussion about how the American casualties were due to Pomona's broadsides. Before Pomona fired her first broadside, President was already shattered with shot holes on the starboard side, the side that Endymion had engaged. Pomona engaged the port side and there was only little damage recorded. In reality, there is no debate since witness testimony from officers on President stated clearly that no casualties were caused due to mainly poor aimed board sides and many American personnel being below deck. That was her history. Now let's talk about her in naval action. So in naval action, the Endymion is a 5th rate 48 gun frigate. Her battle rating sits at 200, which is exactly the same as the Trincomalee, and her crew sits at 340 men, which is kind of low really for her armament if you max her out, but anyways. The Endymion has both bow and stern chasers, where she can carry two 9-pound cannons or two 42-pound carronades. Her broadside guns consist of either 28, 24-pound cannons or 32-pound carronades, and on her weather deck she can carry either 29-pound cannons or 20 42-pound carronades. This puts her cannon broadside weight at 426 pounds, which is more than the 18-pound frigate, the Trincomalee, which is at 351 pounds. It's also a tiny itsy-weeny bit more than the Indefatigable, which sits at 420 pounds. However, it's only 6 pounds more, which won't make a difference. I believe the fact that the Indy can carry 12 pound on her vendor deck instead of 9 pounders will be more of a difference since you'll be able to penetrate more. So yeah, carronade while the Indy is the weakest, the Endymion. She carries full 42 pound carronades, which gives her a broadside of 768 pounds. The Trinco has two more guns in total and can also carry the same configuration, so she sits at 800 pounds. The Indefatigable also is a lot higher. Due to her having 42-pound carronade, she sits at 924 pounds. So yeah, the Endymion is heavily armed, but not as heavily armed as the Indefatigable. Meanwhile, structure-wise, the Endymion does not look good at all. She has a bow structure of 1175, side structure of 4700, and a stern structure of 470, which is less than the Trincomalee, which has a bow structure of 1225, side structure of 4900, and stern structure of 490. So it comes as no surprise that the Indefatigable has a higher structure, with a bow structure of 1575, side structure of 6300, and a stern structure of 630. Armor-wise, things look a bit better. She manages to match the Trinco, with a bow armor of 46 cm, side armor of 60 cm, and stern armor of 24 cm. The Indefatigable still remains up top, however, with bow armor of 42 cm, side armor of 70 cm, and a stern armor of 28 cm. Next up, one of the things she is very famous for, her sailing qualities. So, for a very short time, she had amazing speed, being the fastest ship in the game, hitting 14.98 knots. However, that was only for a short while, so don't get your hopes up. She only, quote-unquote only, does 13.77 knots, which still is the second or the shared first place for fastest ship, sharing it with the Lynx. So not only is she faster than the Indefatigable, which does 12.94 knots, she's also faster than the Trinco, which does 12.39 knots, and pretty much every other ship except the Lynx. With that being said, this is where the good news ends. Her turn rate is not that good. The turn rate of the Trinco is 2.56, while the Endymion sits at 2.46. Granted, this is better than the Indefatigable's 2.38. Meanwhile, the sailing profiles. All three ships suffer from a not-so-great sailing profile. However, sadly, the Endymion has the worst sailing profile of them all, And as a result, even though she is good, she is very much a one-trick pony in terms of sailing profile, and is best with her at best point of sail. Other points of sail is pretty much shit. So, conclusion time. What do I think of the Endymion? Well, personally, I actually love her. Her very limited one-trick pony sailing profile is disappointing. However, her speed, her armament, 24 pounders on the gun deck and 32 pounders on the weather deck is what I run her with, is excellent. I love it. It packs a punch. Although I prefer the Indefatigable, I still love the Endymion, and I would recommend her, the Endymion, to anyone who wants a fast hit and runner, since you can easily just go into battle, hit someone fast and hard, and if need be, you can get out easily, escaping anyone except other Endymions. So with that said, she's a lovely ship, and I can recommend her, but be aware, like I said, and I can't stress it enough, she is very much a one-trick pony. Anyways, I'm gonna end this review here. Thank you all for watching, and I hope to see you next time. Wait, if you liked watching this, please leave a like. If you want to see more, please subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Bye!